violins prepare our hearts for worship as Nancy plays our prelude. To the words of your healing love.
Open our hearts and spirits to receive your glorious directions.
Place your trust in the Lord in all your ways.
Lord, we have come here to give our lives to you.
Amen. You may be seated. Please join me in our opening prayer. Radiant Lord, you shine with purity, power, and truth. Your mercy reflects your compassion, your care, and your love. Transform us into your image as we seek to follow you. Use us to make your presence known throughout the world. In your holy name we pray. Amen. And I guess I'm going to ask you to stand up again as you're able for our opening hymn, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. We will do verses 1, 2, and 4.
Our first scripture comes from, forgive me, so
a lot of stuff in the Bible here. Our first scripture comes from Exodus, chapter 34, verses 29 through 35. Moses came down from Mount Sinai. As he came down from the mountain with the two tablets of the covenant in his hand, Moses did not know that the skin of his face shone because he had been talking with God. When Aaron and all the Israelites saw Moses, the skin of his face was shining, and they were afraid to come near him. But Moses called to them, and Aaron and all the leaders of the congregation returned to him. And Moses spoke with them. Afterward, all the Israelites came near, and he gave them in commandment all that the Lord had spoken with him on Mount Sinai. When Moses had finished speaking with them, he put a veil on his face. But whenever Moses went in before the Lord to speak with him, he would take the veil off until he came out. And when he came out and told the Israelites what had been commanded, the Israelites would see the face of Moses, that the skin of his face was shining, and Moses would put the veil on his face again until he went in to speak with him. Our second reading today comes from 2 Corinthians, verse 3, chapter 3, verse 12, through chapter 4, verse 2. Since then we have such a hope, we act with great boldness, and not like Moses, who put a veil over his face to keep the people of Israel from gazing at the end of the glory that was set aside. But their minds were hardened. Indeed, to this very day, when they hear the reading of the Old Covenant, they say the same veil is still there, since only in Christ is it set aside. Indeed, to this very day, whenever Moses is read, a veil lies over their minds. But when one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And all of us, with unveiled faces, seeing the glory of the Lord as though reflected in a mirror, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, the Spirit. Therefore, since it is by God's mercy that we are engaged in this ministry, we do not lose heart. We have renounced the shameful things that one hides. We refuse to practice cunning or to falsify God's words. But by the open statement of the truth, we command ourselves to the conscience of everyone in the sight of God.
Our gospel reading this morning comes from Luke chapter 9, verses 28 through 36. Now about 8 days after these sayings, Jesus took with him Peter and John and James and went up on the mountain to pray. And while he was praying, the appearance of his face changed, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly they saw two men, Moses and Elijah, talking to him. They appeared in glory and were speaking of his departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Now Peter and his companions were weighed down with sleep, but since they had stayed awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. Just as they were leaving him, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. While he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were terrified as they entered the cloud. From the cloud came a voice that said, "This is my son, my chosen one. Listen to him." When the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone. And they kept silent, and in those days told no one any of the things they had seen. This is the word of God for us, the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Good morning again. So does anyone remember what the sign said today? What is today? What type of Sunday is today? What do we call this? Transfiguration Sunday. Do you know what that means? I don't think all of our little ones do.
We know what it means to be transformed, to transform a car into a robot, right? That transforms it. But transfiguration, it means to completely change the appearance to be more beautiful. Now, why would today be called Transfiguration Sunday? Well, the Bible tells us that one day Jesus took three of his disciples, Peter, James, and John, and went up on a mountain by themselves. Suddenly, Jesus' clothes became dazzling white, a whiter, more so than anyone could ever make them. And then Moses and Elijah appeared before them and began talking to Jesus. They were amazed at the wonderful sight. Do you know what caused Jesus to change? Jesus' clothes to change and become dazzling white? It was because they were in the presence of God. The Apostle Paul said in the letter he wrote to the church at Corinth, "For it is the God who said, 'Let light shine out of darkness.'" He's made this light shine in our hearts so we could know the glory of God that is seen in the face of Christ Jesus. Now you and I, we have many wonderful experiences with Jesus in our lives. When we allow his light to shine through us, others can see that we have the love of Jesus in our heart by seeing his light shining bright within us. Shall we pray? Echo me, please. Dear God, we thank you for the love and joy we experience in Jesus Christ. Help us to reflect that joy in our bright, shining faces with everyone we meet. May your light shine through me each and every day, and may I return to worship again. Amen.
Thank you, Marty. Will you pray with me? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Picture yourself in the disciples' place, Peter, James, and John. Just a day or two before Jesus' transfiguration, you witnessed the miracle of Jesus feeding the 5,000 with 5 loaves and 2 fish. Another time that day, one of you answers Jesus' question of, "Who do you say that I am?" with an emphatic, "You are the Messiah." A short time later, Jesus tells you and the other disciples that he is going to suffer greatly, be rejected, and then killed on the third day. All this the day before Jesus' transfiguration, or a few days before. Jesus ends that day with this pronouncement: "If you want to be my followers, you must take up your cross every day and follow me." And then he says, "Truly I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the kingdom of God." In the past, I've read this verse and I understood it to mean that Jesus was going to spare some folks their death. They wouldn't die, they would just be taken right up into heaven like Elijah, if you remember that from the Old Testament. But I think there's more to this story than that. And Jesus' transfiguration is evidence. So you're going about your day, minding your own business, and Jesus drops by and asks you and a couple of your friends to take a walk up a mountain. And you ascend Mount Tabor with Jesus to spend time in prayer. Now picture Peter, James, and John. They're on their knees just a short distance away from Jesus. It's been a long day. They're very tired. And they're kind of dozing off a little bit. And as Jesus is praying, he is transfigured before their very eyes. Well, they wake up, bright and shiny. Jesus' face is shining bright like the sun, and Moses and Elijah appear there with him, and they're talking with Jesus about his upcoming journey to the cross. Coming out of their dazed slumber, The disciples are astounded by what they see. Peter was so overcome with joy and excitement, he exclaims, "Jesus, it is good that we are here. James and John and I, we're going to build you three dwelling places right here. One for you, one for Moses, one for Elijah. It'll be great." You see, Peter wanted to hold on to that moment, just like it was. Like we all would, I imagine. The text tells us that Peter didn't know what he was saying. Surely none of us would know what to say at the sight of this either, would we? But as Peter is speaking, he's interrupted by a cloud that overshadows them, and the voice of God booms, "This is my son, my chosen. Listen to him." As quickly as the voice came, it was gone, and Jesus was alone. Yes, Peter and I would think James and John wanted to stay on that mountaintop, wouldn't we all? I mean, they've just witnessed Jesus being filled with the light of God, and they've seen Jesus like they've never seen him before. They've heard the voice of God. As Christians, this is where we all want to be. After descending the mountain, the disciples were silent and told no one about what they had seen. Seriously? If you had just witnessed the Transfiguration, wouldn't you be running and telling everyone you knew, anxious to share it with your closest friends? But they didn't. Unlike the Gospel of Luke, the Gospels of Matthew and Mark end this story with Jesus ordering the disciples not to tell anyone. I'm not sure what the difference is here in Luke, but that's the way the other synoptic Gospels end that story. I've always thought that curious, but I think I get it now. On that mountain, the disciples experienced what theologians call a thin place. A place or time where the veil of heaven is parted just a tiny bit, and we get a glimpse of the majesty and the glory of God. A mountaintop experience. I believe the Mount of Transfiguration is where that phrase came from, having a mountaintop experience. It's a place where we simply need to take in the moment to experience for ourselves. I want to go back to Peter for a moment because I think we can really relate to Peter. The danger here for Peter and for us is thinking that these powerful experiences are all that our faith entails. Peter wanted to build dwellings. He wanted to remain right there on that mountain in that experience. He believed that sustaining the mystery and the mystique was the point of the Christian faith. Peter thought he had hit the motherlode. Truly, God is no closer here than anywhere else. But we need to experience these thin places to help us through our daily responsibilities as a Christian, of living as a disciple of Christ. We all need these experiences because this is where our faith is strengthened. In these thin places, the intersanctum of the Holy of Holies, if you will, this is where you experience a closeness and connection with God. God moments. In the second century, Gnosticism taught that God could only be met in the mountaintop experiences, that only a select few would encounter God's glory. In Gnostic belief, the veil we talked about earlier was very important. It helped maintain that mystique, that special private knowledge of God. But we can't fall into that trap, kind of like Peter did momentarily, thinking that this is all there is to our Christian faith. I'm afraid we can start to think of worship this way, if we're not careful. Hear me when I say this. Worship is very important, but is our faith reserved for Sunday mornings? For some of us, there are places that we experience a particular closeness to God. Our sanctuary is such a place, as is our prayer chapel. Some of us experience God in nature, more God moments. So when Jesus, Peter, James, and John came down that mountain, what happens? It's back to business as usual. Their incredible experience was to sustain them in the trenches as they did the daily work of following and proclaiming Christ. This is what I know. If we reach out to God and allow God to part our veil just a tiny bit, then we too will experience God in the thin places. This is what I want you to experience for yourselves, not just once, but more and more as you draw nearer to Christ. Remember this. Jesus brought his friends along when he went up that mountain because he wanted them to experience this part of his story, his transfiguration. He didn't try to explain it to them. God's mystery is not easily explained. Jesus simply let the experience speak for itself. The mystery of God and how God works is an individual experience. No two are exactly the same. My experiences with God are mine. My story is my story, as is yours. And God expects us to share our experiences, our stories with others around us. By hearing how others have experienced God, how they've persevered and grown, we get a better understanding of how God works in our lives. We don't have to explain our story. We simply need to tell it. The good news of the gospel is that God meets us in the thin places. And God meets us in the plain, ordinary, daily places as we live our lives as disciples of Christ. God always, always gives us a story. And this, too, is what I understand is good news. The kingdom of God that Jesus spoke about earlier when he said some would not taste death until they had seen the kingdom of God. Well, that's not when they've been taken up like Elijah into the heavens. The kingdom of God is here, right now, and we are part of it. We see the kingdom of God, and those thin places are where we get a glimpse of even more of what the kingdom of God is. Those experiences that we have on those mountaintops give us a glimpse of the kingdom of God as it should be. And it helps us in our daily task to bring that about. Open your hearts to God. Ask what you can do for God, and then get ready, because God will take it from there. And you will be on the ride of your life. Amen. I'm going to play a piece of special music. I haven't played much lately, and so bear with me. But God just laid it on my heart yesterday. And this is Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus, and then it goes into Open Our Eyes, Lord. It couldn't get any better than this for Transfiguration Sunday. So the words will be on this. If you would like to follow along.
Thank you.
Will you pray with me? God, we want to celebrate. We don't want to listen. We want to stay on the mountaintop with Jesus and set up a festival where everyone can come and play and have a good time. We want our faith to be one of entertainment. But you have called us to listen to him. You have asked us to be ready for the journey. We cannot stay where we are, comfortable and snuggled down in the familiar. There is much to be done. Forgive us, Lord, for our complacency and our stubbornness. Mysterious God, you come to us in all of your transforming glory, whether we want you to or not. You reveal yourself to us, sometimes in the most unlikely places. You transfigure our dull, everyday world into the kingdom of heaven. We do not walk away from encounters with you, the same as we were before we met you. You warm our hearts and you move our lips to praise you. We picture the mountaintop experiences of the disciples, choosing to go up to the mountaintop with Jesus to receive a new vision. But it wasn't what was expected. They were awed and frightened. They didn't know what to do. And Peter wanted to build dwelling places for Moses and Elijah and Jesus where people could come to receive healing and blessing. It would have been so easy to stay up on the mountain and never again descend to the hungering valley below. But Jesus has work for us to do. We are called to receive the blessing, not for ourselves alone, but to give it to others, to offer healing, mercy, forgiveness, compassion, hope, and peace. These are difficult things to do in the face of the anger and hostilities that seem to abound in the world. We are not alone. God is with us. Lord, we ask for your healing mercies for those in need, friends and loved ones that we have mentioned and those we hold close to our hearts. We especially pray for peace and an end to the war and violence in Ukraine. Loving God, as you draw us closer to you, help us to willingly expect your calling. May we seek you in the thin places, but also know that you are with us too in the trenches. For it is in the holy name of Jesus that we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our closing hymn is Christ is the World's Light, and I don't believe this is familiar to you, so Nancy is going to play it all the way through. You may want to open your hymnals to page 188. That may help you with the phrasing a little bit better. We're going to sing verses 1 and 2, but Nancy's going to play it all the way through for us first. Please stand. Now receive this blessing and benediction. May you, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, experience the thin places of your faith. And then take those experiences to sustain you in the everyday humdrum of life. But that's not all. You need to share your story with others. Have a wonderful week. It's great to see you again. Amen.